Hello one and all, welcome to another online video by Einstein Academy. In this video, we'll be looking at the final two learning outcomes from the topic of atomic structure from the JCH2 chemistry syllabus. Learning outcomes J states that candidates should be able to deduce the electronic configurations of elements from successive ionization energy data, while K is to be able to interpret successive ionization energy data of an element in terms of the position of the element within the periodic table. In the last lecture, we started off by defining ionization energy, and then we talked about the factors that influences the ionization energy between different atoms or different species. In this lecture, we are going to discuss how we can interpret successive ionization energy data in order to figure out where the element is in the periodic table, in the sense that what group that element is in and what period the element is in. This is a graph showing the successive ionization energies of sodium. So let's write out the electronic configuration of sodium. It will be 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s1. I emphasize again, when you're doing questions that is related to ionization energies of any elements, always write out the electronic configuration so that at the end of the day, you can figure out what electron you are removing in the next ionization energy or whatever ionization energy that we are interested in. Let us learn how to read this graph. So basically this graph, this is the energy of the first ionization energy. It is very close to zero, but it's not zero. It's somewhere around here in the y-axis. And this is the value of the first ionization energy of sodium. While this is the second ionization energy of sodium, this is the third ionization energy of sodium, so on and so forth. One thing that we can observe from this graph is the following, that the second IE is higher than the first IE, while the third IE is higher than the second IE, so on and so forth. So basically, successive ionization energies always increases. And we have learned this in the previous lecture, and the reason is because when you remove an electron, the number of electrons reduces. However, the number of protons remains exactly the same. So for example, for sodium, it actually has 11 protons. So for this part, it actually has 11 protons and 11 electrons, and all 11 electrons are being attracted to the 11 protons. However, for the second IE, because one electron has already been removed, so the remaining 10 electrons are attracted to 11 protons, and they are more strongly attracted. And hence, the second IE will be higher than the first IE, so on and so forth. This is material that has been covered in the previous lecture. If you're still confused over this section, please feel free to go back and visit the previous lecture. Okay, so one thing that we like to observe is that successive IE generally increases. However, if we look at the increase in the successive IEs, we will notice the following. The second IE to the ninth IE is quite a constant increase in the successive IEs. However, between the first and IE, this jump, you can see that this gradient is actually steeper. And moreover, from the 9th IE to the 10th IE, the jump is ridiculously much bigger, which means that there is a much bigger increase in the 10th ionization energy as compared to the 9th ionization energy. And there is a bigger jump in the second IE as compared to the first IE. And we would like to understand why. As I've mentioned, the key is always to write out the electronic configuration to deduce which electron we are removing. The first IE involves the removal of an electron from the 3s orbital, while the second electron to be removed in the second IE involves the removal of an electron from the 2p orbital. If we can use this simplistic view of the atom, two electrons in the inner shell, then 8 electrons in the second shell, and 1 electron in the outer shell. We'll notice that the first electron to be removed is from the principal quantum number shell 3, and it's much further away from the nucleus as compared to the electrons in the principal quantum number shell 2. What it means is that the electrons in the principal quantum number shell 2 is closer to the nucleus and much more strongly attracted to the nucleus and would require significantly more energy to remove as compared to the electrons in the most outer principal quantum shell 3. What this means is that whenever there is a huge jump in the successive ionization energy, it will mean that the next electron to be removed is from a inner principal quantum shell. So this electron is removed from the 3s orbital, and this electron, this is from the n equals to 3 principal quantum shell. This electron is removed from the n equals to 2 principal quantum shell, which is basically all the 2p6 electrons and all the 2s2 electrons. These two final electrons is removed from the n equals to 3. N equals to 1 principal quantum shell, which is the 1s2 electrons. The 10th ionization energy is much, much bigger as compared to the 9th ionization energy of sodium. And the reason is because this electron that is being removed is from the most inner principal quantum shell, n equals to 1, and is the closest towards the nucleus and the most strongly attracted. Hence, the greatest amount of energy is required to remove this 1s electron. And so what we can see here is also, if we have one electron in the valence shell, then we have 8 electrons in the second shell, and we have 2 electrons in the most inner principal quantum shell. If this data is for all the ionization energies of the atom, then what we can conclude is that it has only one valence electron, means that it is in group 1, and it has 3 principal quantum shells, which would imply that it is in period 3. Okay, so period 3, group 1, that would lead you to conclude that this element is the sodium. Okay, so this is how we interpret successive ionization energies data in order to be able to figure out the position of the element in the periodic table by deducing the number of valence electrons so that we can deduce the group and to deduce the total number of principal quantum shells, which will allow us to deduce its period. In words, there are relatively bigger jumps between the first and second IEs, as well as between the 9th and 10th IE. The second IE involves the removal of an inner 2p electron that is more strongly attracted to the nucleus than the outermost 3s electron. This is from the inner principal quantum shell as compared to the 3s electron. Similarly, the 10th IE involves the removal of an innermost 1s electron that's from the inner principal quantum shell that is more strongly attracted to the nucleus than the previous outer 2s electron, as I've mentioned before. There are also 3 different sets of energy levels, 1 set, 2 set, and 3 set, telling us that there are 3 principal quantum shells. So there are 3 shells in the atom, and hence the conclusion for this part can also be said that it is from period 3. Because basically the number of the period it is in tell us how many principal quantum shells that element that or the atom has. And since there's only one electron in the outermost shell, the atom belongs to group 1. So period 3, group 1 is the sodium atom. Okay, so that sums up how we can interpret successive ionization energy data. And in the next few slides, we are going to look at 3 past year A-level questions that specifically test on ionization energies. November 2007, paper 1, question 5. The table gives the successive ionization energies for an element X. What could be the formula of the chloride of X? So when we deal with this kind of questions, what we need to figure out is what is the increase in the ionization energy as we go from the first IE to the second IE. The increase in the value of the IE as we go from the first to the second is 850. And when we go from this to this, it's 900. From this to this is 2001. And from this to this, it's 1002. And from this to this, it's 6003. Okay, so if you were to compare the jumps in the ionization energy between the first, second, third, fourth, fifth, and sixth, you can see that the biggest jump is between fifth and sixth. And this is very obviously that it's a very, very big jump. And what this means is that the sixth electron to be removed must be from an inner principal quantum shell as compared to the fifth electron. What this means then is that basically it has 5 valence electrons, and we know that basically the group number is an indication of the number of valence electrons. If an atom has 5 valence electrons, then it must be in group 5. I'd just like to mention that in this table, it only gives us these first 6 ionization energies, so we are not able to deduce the period, because if we were to be able to deduce the period of an element, we must be given all the ionization energies of the atom so that we can know how many total shells it is. If the information given in this chart is stated such that the first 11 IEs of an atom is given, then we cannot conclude that there's only 3 principal quantum shells, because it could be true that there's actually 25 electrons to be removed, and they only show us the first 11. So I emphasize again, only if they tell us that this chart shows us all the ionization energies of atom, can we use the chart to deduce how many principal quantum shells there are. However, by using the jumps in the ionization energies, we are always able to deduce how many electrons are there in the valence shell, and hence we are always able to deduce the group number of that atom that it belongs to. Okay, so we have already deduced that this element X is in group 5. So if it's in group 5, it means that it's a non-metal and it forms covalent bonds. And because it has 5 electrons, it means that it needs to form an additional 3 covalent bonds to achieve octet configuration. Because octet configuration is a total number of 8 electrons in the outer shell. So 3 covalent bonds to achieve octet. And hence, chlorine has to form 1 covalent bond because it's in group 7. This is group 7. So it has to form 1 covalent bond because it's 1 electron short of octet. And hence, the formula for the chloride of X, a non-metal chloride, would be XC3. Okay, so we use this data to figure out the group number in which element X is in first, before we can then decide what will be the chemical formula of X when it bonds with chlorine. For this graph shows the first 13 ionization energies for element X. So let us see what information we can get from this graph. What we can get from this graph is that there are 2 electrons in the valence shell, because this electron, which experiences a jump in the ionization energy, is from the inner principal quantum shell as compared to the 2 valence electrons. There are 2 valence electrons, and this can immediately allow us to deduce that it is in group 2. All right. Can we actually say that there are a total of 3 principal quantum shells as shown here? The answer is no, because the question says that the graph shows the first 13 ionization energies. It does not tell us whether is it that this atom only has 13 ionization energies. I can tell you that it's definitely not true that it only has 13 ionization energies, because for any atom, there will only be 2 electrons in the 1s orbital, and the last part of the ionization energy will only be 2 dots that increases gradually, because this one must be the 1s electrons. But you can notice that here there are 3 dots, which means that this is definitely not from the 1s electrons. So there are definitely more than 13 electrons in this element X, and we do not know how many total ionization energies this element X has, and hence we are not able to deduce the period of this element X, but we have already deduced that it is in group 2. And more often than not, that is the most important part, the group number of an element X, because it will tell us the number of valence electrons, which will decide the chemical properties of any element. So what can we deduce about element X from the graph? It's a D block element, so we cannot deduce this, because for a D block element, it has to have D electrons, But the thing is that we're not able to deduce whether it has so many electrons or not. It's in group 2 of the periodic table. This is what we have deduced. It's in group 3. This is not correct, because if it's in group 3, there will be 3 valence electrons before it experiences a jump. It's in the second period. This is definitely not true, because although we cannot deduce what period it is in, but we can tell that it at least has 3 principal quantum shells. So if it at least has 3 principal quantum shell, it must be an element from period 3 downwards, and it cannot be in period 2. So the answer for this question is option B. The final question, November 2013, paper 1, question 4. The first 6 ionization energies of an element M in kilojoules per mole are shown. So as always, what we did previously is to first calculate the increase. I'm just going to use a rough value because I'm doing this off my head. So this is about 607. This is, I don't know, the order of about 1,000. This is about an order of about 1,001. While this is about an order of 4,005. And this is about an order of about 1,007. So you can see that this 4,005 is where the jump occurs. And what it means is that the removal of the fifth electron, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, the fifth electron is from the inner principal quantum shell. So as you can see, right, what I've been doing over and over is to figure out where the jump occurs and to figure out which electron is from the inner principal quantum shell, so that we know that if the fifth electron is from the inner principal quantum shell, it will mean that it has 4 valence electrons. And if it has 4 valence electrons, it has to be in group 4. Okay, and this is the most important part. M forms is only chloride by heating M with chlorine. So if it's in group 4, it is 4 electrons short of octet, which means that it will form 4 covalent bonds. And chlorine is in group 17, it's in group 7, which means that it is 1 electron short, which means that it will form 1 covalent bond. And hence, if we were to deduce the formula for MCl, it would be MCl4. Okay? And the answer for this question would be C. One atom of M will react with 2 molecules of Cl2, and in doing so, they will form the correct molecular formula, MCl4. Okay? So finally, to wrap this up, the learning outcomes J, to deduce the electronic configurations of elements from successive ionization energy data, and to be able to interpret successive ionization energy data of an element in terms of the position of the element within the periodic table. So basically, given the successive ionization energy data, be able to figure out what group that element is in, and if sufficient data is given, be able to figure out what period the element is in. Hope this clears up the final 2 learning outcomes from J and K. And with this, we have finished the entire chapter for atomic structure from the JCH2 chemistry syllabus. If you like this video, do hit the like and subscribe button. And I'll be making more videos for the next few chapters from the JCH2 chemistry syllabus. Stay tuned and see you again.